us Rangers, we be making the list, checking it twice, gonna find out who's naughty or nice. So the DS era is known for some of its more bizarre game concepts. The new touchscreen opened up a lot of new options. Some games just use it as an auxiliary, while others made it part of their core identity. One such game in the latter category is Pokémon Ranger, a fairly solid, albeit simple game released at the tail end of Generation 3. The game did reasonably okay, selling a respectable 2.39 million units. While not as much as other spin-off games like the Mystery Dungeon series, it was apparently enough to convince Nintendo to greenlight a sequel. Flash forward to 2008, where we saw the release of Pokémon Ranger Shadows of Almia. Oh boy, this game. I have some very fond memories for this game. I actually got it for Christmas the year it came out. At least, I think. I don't actually remember. Either way, the more important part here is the game improves over its predecessor in virtually every single way. The gameplay is better, the story and world building are significantly improved, and the overall presentation makes for a much more enjoyable experience. In terms of marketing material, just like the first game, there were a few additional pieces created in other mediums that were used to help promote the game. The main of these was the two-part Pokémon Ranger and the Kidnapped Riolu, which was a pair of episodes in the Diamond and Pearl anime which followed Kellen, the game's male protagonist, teaming up with Ash and Co. to help rescue a special Riolu that knew the move Aura Sphere. Special? Do I need my two front teeth for Christmas? Should I just keep it in? No, fuck it, I'm keeping it in. In addition, there was a 4-chapter long manga called Darkrai Mission's Story, Pokémon Ranger Vatnage the Comic, try saying that 3 times fast, which was a direct adaptation of the game's story. Overall, however, the amount of material was not quite comparable to that of the first game, which got multiple mangas and was the subject of the 9th Pokémon movie. Sales-wise, this one only managed to sell 2.3 million units, but still has its fair share of fans, including YouTuber Jaden Animations, who called it the best Pokémon game you never played, to which I think I agree. I quite adore this game. There's a lot about it to like, so I would like to take today to go over some of those things and maybe convince you that this game is worth looking at. Also, because of the timing and visual aesthetic I chose for this video, I'm going to somehow try to tie this into Christmas as well. We'll see how that works out. So let's start quickly by looking at the overall presentation of the game before we get into the nitty-gritty of everything. Generally speaking, this game looks pretty similar to the first one. In fact, many of the sprites are reused from that game. The overall look and feel of the game are not all that different either. The top screen has been changed a bit though, and looks a lot better in my opinion. The biggest change is allowing the player to switch between views, instead of trying to cram all of the information into the screen at the same time. Musically, this game is a significant improvement. Many of the capture tracks are quite good, and overall, I like the soundtrack a lot better this time around, which is why I'm going to actually be using quite a bit of music from this game, as opposed to last time when I just used a bunch of Gates to Infinity music. And with that, let's jump into the game a bit more deeply now, shall we? The gameplay in Shadows of Almia does a lot to improve upon the first game. The big difference that you notice on first glance is this. Unlike the first game, which required a set number of loops in succession, the game instead gives each Pokémon a set number of friendship points that need to be transferred by drawing loops around them, with the gauge slowly draining back down when loops are not being drawn. Also different this time around is that a capture is automatically completed once the required number of loops are drawn. This means that there is no room for bonus EXP to be gained from drawing more than the required loops. But the game makes up for this by adding a series of potential bonuses that can be earned based on how the capture goes. For example, the player can get more EXP if they manage to get a capture without— Oh my god, I'm not wearing gloves! I'm not wearing the gloves, fuck, how did I forget the gloves? Give me a second. I'm gonna be back. How did I manage to not wear gloves? And I left my watch on. I don't care about that, I'll leave my watch on. But here we go. This looks right, right? This is how it's supposed to look? This is the correct outfit? Okay, perfect. How? Where was I? For example, the player can get more EXP if they manage to get the capture without lifting the stylus, taking any damage, doing so quickly, or using a Poke Assist with a type advantage. The player is also assigned a letter grade ranging from C to S depending on how many bonuses are received. which is then recorded in the Ranger browser for the captured Pokemon. The game also provides some new ways to aid with capture that are not in the previous game, mainly the power charge mechanic, which is unlocked about halfway through the game. This allows the player to first double, and then later quadruple the amount of friendship conveyed with each loop, allowing them to make quick work of captures, including bosses, which require an upwards of 50 to 100 regular loops to capture in some cases. The drawback is that the player has to hold the stylus in place in order to charge power, leaving the capture disc vulnerable to attacks. The player also loses their charge if the capture line is broken, requiring power to be built up again. So in some cases, it's more of a detriment than a gain due to the time required to charge up the styler that could be used to draw more loops. It also cannot be used in conjunction with a Poke Assist, meaning that the player has to pick which one they think will be more beneficial for the current situation. On the topic of Poke Assists, those have been altered as well. Due to the change to the capture mechanics, there is more variety in terms of what Poke Assists do. This time around, all Poke Assists affect the player's capture line, and are able to do more than just immobilize the target, with the status effects of slow and tired being added. In addition, some have more unique effects, such as dark removing hazardous substances from the ground, or rock allowing a small amount of friendship to be transferred by flicking the stylus at the target instead of drawing loops. However, that cannot be used to complete the capture, and the player has to draw a loop to finish it off. Lastly, unlike the last game, all 17 existing types are represented as Poke Assist this time around, with Dragon and Normal now being available. Furthermore, the game adds a new Electric-type Poke Assist, with the original from the first game being renamed to Recharge. In addition to Poke Assists, field moves have been slightly altered as well. The basic premise hasn't changed, but now moves can go up to level 5, and new area moves have been introduced, which can be used if the player is in a specific location, and can do a number of things such as allowing the player to light up a dark room, or put out a forest fire. In addition, some moves allow the player to ride on a Pokemon's back, adding much needed variety in terms of the game's movement system. Some allow the player to cross bodies of water or lava, while others enable faster travel throughout the Almia region. Riding on the back of Doduo drastically increases the player's movement speed, allowing for easier evasion of wild Pokemon, just making backtracking that much more tolerable. Personally, having this option is great because the default movement speed in these games is a tad slow for my taste sometimes. The other major improvement is the ability to ride on the back of Staraptor, allowing the player to fly to a number of major in-game locations in an instant. This was in the first game in the form of the Dragonite bus, but it could only be used from a ranger station, whereas this one can be used from virtually any outdoor location, which vastly increases the availability of the feature. Furthermore, since the player is not restricted from taking Pokemon out of the area they were captured in from the onset, the player can pick up a Staraptor or Doduo to save for later. This isn't a huge deal because both are fairly easy to find, but it's also helpful to be able to do this. Also, while it's never necessary to use a Pokemon from another area to progress, it's still quite useful to be able to have access to certain Poke Assists by bringing them in from the outside. Another way exploration is altered is the addition of new underwater areas. This allows the player to find and capture Pokemon that live in the sea, and wouldn't make sense to be found elsewhere. Obviously, when entering these areas, the player can't bring their group of friend Pokemon, instead having a completely different set that is retained between visits. This does come with the downside of not being able to use a partner Pokemon, however. And while yes, most of these Pokemon are water type, in fact, I don't think there are any in this game that aren't, the game still does offer a tiny bit of Poke Assist variety. Not much, but still a little. This honestly is something that could have been remedied quite easily due to many of them already possessing secondary types. In terms of the player's partner Pokemon, this game deviates from the original by having multiple options. This game offers a total of 17 different partner Pokemon, one for each Poke Assist, with the exception of Recharge, for obvious reasons. Due to using the same Poke Assist as regular wild Pokemon, there is only one segment to the partner gauge this time around. The player starts by having to pick one out of three during the opening sequences of the game, and is then able to obtain the rest as they progress. However, the player can only still use one at a time, with the remainder being placed on standby in a place called Partner Farm, which is owned by the player character's family. Three of these available partners, Krikatot, Krogunk, and Mime Jr., are all obtained just by playing normally, with the rest being confined to side quests. Oh, that's another new thing about this game. There's a lot more content this time around. This game has a total of 60, mostly optional side missions that can be completed. Most of these are fairly straightforward and can be completed fairly quickly. By completing a quest, the player obtains one of two different types of reward. Either a new partner Pokémon, as mentioned earlier, or an upgrade to the player's capture styler. These are by no means necessary to complete the game, but they are beneficial nonetheless. The other type of optional mission in this game are the special and extra missions. However, unlike the first game, these are not obtainable natively on the cartridge. Instead, they were available to be downloaded from the internet during set time periods. This poses a challenge for new players, as these missions are completely unobtainable, both on the actual cartridge itself and on the Wii U Virtual Console release. Unfortunately, this locks the player out from getting the game's transferable Pokémon, which include, as per series tradition, the Manaphy Egg, as well as a special Riolu that knows the move Aura Sphere, and a Darkrai. As with the first game, these Pokémon were transferable to any of the Generation 4 games, but were limited to one per physical cartridge. One last piece of post-game content is the Capture Arena, which was also a location in the first game, but this one has changed quite a bit. In the first game, it was basically just a time attack capture rush where you tried to capture as many Pokémon as you could before time ran out. This time around, it is a series of rooms that contain more powerful versions of the game's bosses. Unlike the main game, this section is actually fairly challenging, and the player would benefit greatly from obtaining all of the upgrades to their styler from doing quests. In addition, the game does a lot to build up the world and expand the lore of the Pokémon Rangers. The opening sequence of the game is set in a school where the player is learning to be a Pokémon Ranger. The game also strongly implies that some of the Rangers from the first game also attended this school. In addition to seeing where Rangers learn their skill set, the game also introduces us to the operators and mechanics, to other jobs performed by Ranger School graduates that are used to support what Rangers do. Operators support Rangers in various ways, such as recharging their capture styler, and some, called top operators, also provide guidance to a Ranger during both story missions and side quests. They're also the ones responsible for doling out the rewards for completing quests. Mechanics, on the other hand, help by handling some of the technology used by Rangers, like their capture stylers, as well as being a touch point for information regarding specific technologies. The game also introduces us to the Ranger Union, a location that was mentioned briefly in passing in the last game, but is formally shown here. Between the Ranger School and Ranger Union being located here, it's heavily implied that the Almia region is the origin and primary place of operation for the Rangers. At the Ranger Union, not only do we see the return of Professor Hastings, but also Murph, the lovable goof who was stationed at Ringtown with the player in the first game, who this time manages PR for the Union. Guess that's what happens when you're just bad at your job all the time. You get a different one that you could actually do. I don't know, is that mean? That sounds a little mean. We are also introduced to the character of Chairperson Irma, who is the founder and leader of the Pokémon Rangers. It is revealed that she, alongside Professor Hastings and Principal Lamont of the Ranger School, were all childhood friends, and the Ranger Union is the culmination of their shared dreams and ambitions. The major new thing shown in this game is the introduction of Top Rangers, a group of Rangers who are of a special distinction. They are allowed to assign themselves missions as they deem necessary, but can also receive ones from command as situations require. The game tells us that there are 12 in total, but only 4 ever seen in this game, as the others are implied to be in other regions. Top Rangers are marked by the type of styler that they carry, the Fine Styler, which instead of being a handheld device like the ones used by regular area Rangers, is worn on the wrist and gives the Ranger access to more tools, such as the aforementioned Power Charge feature. One notable alteration to the game is the way in which the Ranger uniform has changed. In the previous game, this uniform was only used by the Rangers stationed in Ringtown, that being Spencer, Lunik, Solana, and Murph. This time around, this is simply the base uniform for all of them. There's still quite a bit of variation, of course, but the variation compared to the first game is far more limited. In addition to expanding the actual structure of the Ranger Union, this game actually introduces us to the more mythological elements of the world. This makes sense given the context of the time this game was released, given that Generation 4 focuses pretty heavily on myths in the main games. The first and fairly minor instance of this is the Pledge Stone, which is found in the Ranger School, which allegedly, if someone were to make a pledge in front of it, that would come true. This is shown in the game when the player, Keith and Rhythmi, do ultimately see their wishes granted as all three reunite at the Ranger Union as top Rangers for the player and Keith, and a top operator for Rhythmi. Now granted, it's stated outright that these three were singled out while they were in school, and that's why they're reunited, but it's still a case where a symbol is being assigned meaning and significance beyond the physical form that it has. The game also provides a history of the Almia region, which has, at the time of the game's events, largely faded from the public consciousness, and is mostly presented as a folktale. As per the game, it goes like this. Long before, long, long ago, there was an old king who ruled over all of Almia. The king of Almia had three boys, each of them crowned as a prince. The king was a kindly one, who sought and thought only peace for his kingdom. All he desired was harmony among his people and Pokémon. But the three princes, being young and full of vigor, failed to restrain themselves. They fell into acrimony and fought with wild and reckless abandon. The old king, in much anguish, and after great contemplation, banished the princes. The eldest son, cloaked in a raiment of red, he sent to a volcanic land. The second son, clad in fairness of yellow, the king sent to a desert land. The youngest son, dressed in the liveries of blue, he allowed to stay. With the eldest princes gone, the last child claimed the castle as his home. The king, once kindly, became racked with anger, solitude, and bitter guilt. Those feelings transformed his entire being. The darkness in his heart summoned forth the darkness in the world. The darkness in the world kept pulling and pulling. When deep darkness did arrive in the kingdom of Almia, the prince in blue stood. He willed himself to shine the light, a light that turned the darkness into light. While the artifacts alluded to in this story are real, and their power actually exists and works, the game never outright confirms that the events described actually happened. It could very likely have happened completely differently. As what happens with the distant past, especially with things that are not written down, is that stories often take a life of their own, and they change as they get passed down orally from generation to generation. It's not a theme that is overtly explored here, but it is something that is nonetheless a feature at work. Ultimately, it doesn't matter to the plot at all, because the accuracy of the story isn't the important bit, but rather the actual significance of the gems themselves and their power, which again is quite real. The main theme of the story is that of the interplay between humans and nature. We see this a lot in the aesthetics of the two main sides of the conflict. The Ranger Union is depicted as containing a giant tree growing through the middle, with the more technological buildings surrounding it. Now, the trunk of the tree itself is not visible inside, but it's very clear that it is meant to symbolize the way in which the Rangers use technology in harmony with and in service of nature. On the flip side, Team Dim Sun is not shown to have the same regard for nature. Beyond their disrupting the wild Pokémon for their aims, one need look no further than the substance that they are most strongly associated with, oil. This is shown pretty early on when it's revealed that the Gigaremo units run by burning oil, which is the cause of the forest fire in Vien Forest early in the game, and later is remarked upon again in Hubara Desert when one gets mistaken for a coffee machine. Wouldn't that taste terrible? Like, I don't like coffee at all, but I don't know if I would drink something that smells like oil. Towards the end of the game, when it's revealed that All True Inc. is a front for Team Dim Sun's operations, this connection becomes stronger, as All True is, drumroll please, an oil drilling company. The association between these groups and a substance which, while having contributed greatly to the advancement of human society, has also been slowly killing the planet, is more than a bit subtle here. On top of that, the game shows us that the goals of Team Dim Sun aren't entirely evil, but actually started from a good place. All True Inc. was originally looking for a new source from which to produce energy, is their oil wells were starting to dry up. This is actually not that dissimilar from the actions of some major oil companies today, which are actively investing in renewable energy, apparently seeing the writing on the wall and following a potential new business venture to avoid insolvency. This, on the face of it, is not inherently a bad thing. Blake Hall, at multiple points, talks about providing a new future for the Almia region, usually in terms that sound pretty good. Due to the good-sounding nature of these goals, it's not surprising that despite being the villains, their name is derived from the English word altruism, because that's how they pitch themselves. This is reflected in other languages as well. In Japan, the name for the company is Angel, or Anhel, if you want to be fancy about it. In French, the name is derived from the word for loyalty. However, we learn these plans get twisted, and eventually former Altru president Brighton Hall discovers the Shadow Crystal, eventually being drawn in by the darkness as a potential energy source. This drives him to change his son Wyatt's name to Blake at a special ceremony in front of the crystal, which later corrupts his young son, who later drives his father from the company. Brighton spent the rest of his life searching for a way to save his son, not having succeeded before passing on sometime before the start of the game. Again, when it comes to the Halls, we've got some name symbolism going on here. Brighton obviously being derived from the word bright, and the names Blake and Wyatt being common English names that are lexically similar to the words black and white. This is shown even more strongly in the Japanese version, where the two names literally translate to black hole and white hole, the latter of which is actually a real thing in theoretical physics. His other language names follow a similar pattern. His grandfather's name is a bit interesting here. The English name Doyle is an Irish name, derived from a Gaelic word meaning black stranger. So we see perhaps, despite good intentions, these aims were always meant to go south. In the case of Team Dim Sun, we see this dark underbelly even more clearly, where the name in every language has some kind of meaning that would carry a dark connotation, if not just outright having the word dark in it. So we see an organization promising a new energy source looking to be the good guys, but fronting a criminal syndicate who are very overt in their evil plans to enslave all Pokemon in Almia for the purpose of generating this new limitless energy. Ultimately, it's a case of hubris on the part of those involved. Brighton Hall thought he could harness the Shadow Crystal, but later learned its power was too great. Hell, even Blake Hall learns this when he tried to unleash the true power of the Shadow Crystal, only to cause Darkrai to go berserk and turn on him. It was only with the power of light and balance, exemplified by Almia's four top rangers, that things are corrected, and the Shadow Crystal ends up being cleansed of its darkness to become the Luminous Crystal. And that's the story of how a group of teenagers ascended a tower and stopped an evil businessman in order to save Christmas. I told you I was gonna tie it into Christmas somehow, even if I was going to really have to force it. God, what am I doing with my life? Another thing about this game that I quite like is the usage of foreshadowing and setting up major plot points early on. None of this game's twists are super unexpected, and in fact, some of them are quite obvious. But that doesn't negate the fact that this game is quite tightly written and sets things up way before they happen. The first major instance of this is during the initiation ritual at the Ranger School, where you see Mr. Kincaid and Isaac doing something in the basement. We don't know what, but we know it's secret enough that he blocks it off following the incident. This is later reinforced when two Tangrowth bust out from there during the graduation ceremony. Again, what exactly was going on down there? There's no way these people would end up being the bad guys, right? Similarly, we see the three partner Pokemon the player gets to choose from as their first partner Pokemon going berserk on the beach, before we even learn about the Gigaremo units, but the behavior is still the same. The dialogue drops some pretty subtle hints as well, mentioning a cargo ship passing by. Another point that gets set up very early on is during the one-day internship, when we meet Isaac's sister Melody, to which we see very quickly the affection that the two have for each other, one that later gets used by Team Dim Sun to manipulate him into complying with their wishes. Also, we learn that Isaac gets employed by Altru Inc., which is a fairly interesting place for a Ranger School graduate to go. Why would he be there? In fact, the entire Team Dim Sun is controlled by Altru is set up very early on just by looking at the color scheme of the lobby and suit worn by Blake Hall and Wheeler. I just maybe find it a bit odd that they sport the same two colors as the bad guys. Also, it makes the fairly dubious nature of Altru's goodness even more pronounced, because what good guy do you know that is represented by the colors black and purple? And this is where everything ties together, especially after finding out that Kincaid is part of Team Dim Sun. He literally chose Isaac for his intellect to develop the technology needed to realize Team Dim Sun's plans, got him a job as Altru so he could continue working on it without realizing what he was doing, and used the time they spent together at the Ranger School to continue to string him along. It's actually a fairly well thought out sequence of events, and helps tie the school arc into the rest of the plot. Overall, the game is just very tightly written and is an extremely well executed story, even again if the twists are fairly obvious. In addition, when it comes to the attention to detail, when it comes to the naming and color schemes, are things that I think should be commended quite strongly. So overall, how does this game stack up? This game blows the first one out of the water. This game took basically every part that weakened the first game and fixed it, making for a much more enjoyable experience. Is it on the same level as Mystery Dungeon? Of course not. But that's a very hard bar to clear for any game. However, out of the plethora of spin-offs that were released during the DS era, this is definitely one of the stronger ones. Now that leaves us with one more game to look at. We still have to see where they went from here and ask the most important question. Why did the series come to a sudden end? That and more next time when I cover Pokémon Ranger Guardian Signs. But until then, have a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. Peace.